My name is Allison Summers. I'm the executive director at headquarters. I have some other headquarters staff on the line. And that is, I know I at least have Jamie and Megan. So if you have headquarters questions, we're also here and you can send us notes. But I want to welcome you to this call. I'm going to get started with a few announcements and then hand it over to your wonderful Greater Diversity Committee. So before we begin, we would love to continue conversations through the Zonta app. So if you have not downloaded it yet, please do. If you haven't posted on it recently, please do. We also have two events coming up that I want to share with you that you can also sign up for. The next Zonta Says Now USA Think Tank is on April 29th. Whether you are a member of the Zonta USA clubs, you are welcome to attend this think tank if it's an area of interest to you. Go to zonta.org to the events tab and you can sign up. Another thing coming up that we want to share with you is the Zonta Spirit for Club Presidents, and that will be presented by the Zonta Spirit Working Group. So there are two times that call will be offered. So feel free to take a look at it as well. Anything that we're doing in events, any webinars, any upcoming things are in the Zonta events section. So how this call is going to work, we ask right now that you go ahead and mute yourself. At the end of the call, everybody will be allowed to open their mics and have a conversation. Again, feel free to use chat. It is there for you to connect, comment on positive things that our wonderful speaker is sharing with you. Please don't use the hand raise feature. We're not going to be following that today. This is a meeting, not a webinar. But if you have a question, Ela is going to be monitoring any questions put in chat. So what will help her is if you write the word question in all caps in front of your comment. So that way it will help her find those questions if you put them in. But I know our lovely speaker will invite you for some conversation during this session as well. And then at the end, we'll have some open Q&A. So that's it. That's some of the background information to get us started. So let's get underway. It is my pleasure to introduce to you today our session, which is the importance of diversity and inclusion in Zonta. This call will be recorded, so please be aware of that. And now I would like to introduce our lovely Zonta International President, Uta Schultz. Uta, welcome to the call.
Thank you, Allison. Dear Zontians, dear guests, happy greetings from Frankfurt. I'm just staying here for the European seminar to meet friends from all over Europe, a diverse mixture of Zontians from Europe. And the opening will be in 50 minutes, so I'm sorry I have to watch the seminar on the records. But do you know that we are making Zonta history now? Why? The first seminar about diversity in our Zonta world. This is a new topic, an old and a new topic. And I'm very happy that Eric, Ela, and Madalena, together with the international board liaison Sandy, are caring for the topic. It's an important point for me because it's also part of the Zonta spirit to appreciate diversity. I know we cannot rock the entire Zonta world and world within biennium and become absolutely diverse. But to have this as a topic, have it on our mind, think about it, talk about it, discuss it in our clubs. Are we diverse? What do we envision? What do we need? Let's talk about the beauty of diversity, the enrichment of life. Life is beautiful and diverse, and let's live a diverse Zonta life and appreciate diversity because we learn from others. Happy to give over, to hand over the floor to Eric, Madalena, Ela, and board liaison Sonia, Sally, and enjoy the session. And I'm very curious to hear more from Heidi. And so I cross my fingers. Have a wonderful day, a wonderful webinar. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, President Ute. Thanks very much for joining in. A very good morning, good afternoon, good evening to all my dear Zonshan friends. I am Zonshan Eric Elavia, Chair of the Greater Diversity Team, and I would be more than happy to introduce my core team working group of Greater Diversity. We have Ila Pandya, who is a member of the Zonta Club of Pottsville District 9 US. We have Madelina Magnusson. She's a member of Zonta Club of Molndal in Gothenburg, Sweden. And our liaison, Sandy Van Brown. She's the International Director on Zonta Foundation and for Zonta Foundation for Women Board. We all together have prepared this seminar, and I'm very happy to see such large numbers over here. And thanks a lot for supporting this seminar. Thank you so much. Before we begin with the seminar, I need to get you all acquainted with the biennial goal on diversity. Value diversity and respect for people of all backgrounds. We believe that fostering a diverse and inclusive global community is a powerful platform to bring about the social change needed to make our vision for gender equality a reality. A diverse community of Zonshans is essential to our ability to achieve our mission to create a more equitable future. And we must strive harder to be an organization where everyone feels empowered to be their full, authentic selves. My dear Zonshans, as far as diversity is concerned, next slide, please. Yes, diversity, I have already mentioned, again, I'm saying every club needs to have a diversity committee. The main four highlights, I would like to go into details. Create a welcoming community. Pay attention to what is important. Build a learning environment. And most important, my dear Zonshan friends, be mindful of barriers. These are the four pillars on which diversity can be acknowledged, and you can have these clubs, I'm sorry, diversity groups in your respective clubs. So let's begin with our seminar. I would like to extend a warm welcome to our speaker, Heidi Moore, and I would like to read and introduce our speaker for this session. Heidi Moore is an equity, diversity, and inclusion leader and practitioner who drives and delivers equity, diversity, and inclusion strategies through organizational development. Heidi has developed and led the EDI strategies in a variety of industries and business types, including business to business, consumer goods, consumer services, durable goods, financial services, healthcare, hospitality, insurance, and technology. Her internal leadership and consulting work experience has been with many notable organizations. Heidi holds more than 23 years of experience in business community engagement, human resource organizational development, and executive development. Heidi has a Bachelor of Arts degree and completed her master's requirements at Columbia College in Chicago, Illinois. She currently serves on the boards of the Beckham Stapleton Little League, Good Friends, Milwaukee Film National, Hispanic Corporate Council, Prospanica, United Way Diversity Leadership Council, and Walnut Way. Previously, she served on the board of directors for the YWCA on Greater Milwaukee, Prospanica, African American World Culture Center, and the Business Council. She is also the recipient of the Black Excellence Award and was featured in Black Enterprise Magazine and a YMCA Black Achiever. I think this is one of the best speakers you have had till date. A warm welcome to you, Heidi, and over to you now. Thank you.
Oh my goodness. Thank you so much, Eric and the committee. And really, great evening, great afternoon, and a fabulous morning. Thank you so much for having me here today. I am going to share some slides to get us started, and almost there. All right, so I want to put it in slideshow and then we will get started. All right, are you able to see my slides?
Yes.
Okay, wonderful, thank you. So thank you so much for joining us today for this learning session. I had a chance to see the chat, you know, but if you haven't had a chance, please add the name of your country or city or region of the world that you're in. I cannot see the chat anymore, but Ela is going to be my wonderful partner for today, and so she can share more. But before I began to show my slides, I could see there's representation from almost around the entire world.
Sorry.
And so that's so wonderful. And it's so exciting, especially for this topic of diversity, as well as many other aspects.
I'm not good on
about today.
And it's really hot and stuffy in there. Like,
I'm gonna pause.
I'm afraid if I do, then all the children are gonna think that's okay.
Jean?
So I'm okay. Jean,
I'm having a hard time muting you. There we go. We're all good. Thank you, Heidi. Sorry for the interruption.
No problem at all. This is an example of what the world is like today, right? So in any case, thank you so much for joining from today. I also would like to thank your president, Uta, such wonderful opening remarks. And it really excited me to hear more about the, you know, the goal of diversity and the deep appreciation for wanting to learn more. The Greater Diversity Group has been so fabulous to work with, and they've been so patient with me. Eric shared some of the things that I'm doing with my, you know, sort of my day job. And so it has been quite busy, but the diversity group, the Greater Diversity Group, has been so amazing in supporting me behind the scenes in order for us to come today. So I would like to, let's see here. Okay, all right. So let's get started with me first sharing a little bit more about myself. So I want to ask you, this is the next opportunity to chat. And then again, I won't be able to see your answers, but Ela, I'm going to ask, you know, when I ask you, if you could just share a little bit of the responses. So I'm going to share a little bit more about me. And as I do so, I ask that at your own comfort level, please share more about yourselves when I talk about something that creates a connection with you. So let's get started. I'm moving my controls. All right. So when I share a little bit more about myself, normally I start here. I start with my family. So at the top, you can see I've identified my mother. Her name is Mary Smith. And all of the folks that are standing there beside her are her brothers and sisters. Some of them, you know, related because they were born as brothers and sisters, and others through marriage. Now, those aren't all of her brothers and sisters. Those are not all of my aunts and uncles. However, it is a good amount of them. The gentleman she's standing next to is an uncle, and he had just celebrated his 75th birthday. So this was actually a couple of years ago. And so, anyways, here's the thing about my mom. My mom grew up and born in the southern part of the United States, in a state called Arkansas. However, as a child, my grandmother, her mother, moved to the northern part of the United States. This was during a time when there was segregation based upon the color of your skin or based upon the concept of race. We won't talk much about race today. However, if you're familiar with United States history, then you may have some understanding. And race is also a concept that other countries have adopted as well. So the reason that's important, I'll share a little bit more about why that's important in a moment, but please understand that knowing and having that knowledge therefore has an impact on me. On the bottom, you see my former husband, but life partner. We have spent the last 30 plus years together. We actually were married for 20 years. And then before that, we were together for 8 years. And then we still are partners when it comes to our kids. We have 4 kids, and you can see us holding our first child when she was a baby. So next to that picture is my first daughter, and her name is Tyler. Tyler is in the film industry. She does behind the scene and works on TV shows in California state in the United States. And she currently is in Cuba right now doing some grassroots community organization work. Haley is the next one. And Haley just recently completed her first 4 years of college in psychology. Savannah is next to her. Savannah is 2 years in college now, and she is studying nursing. And then next to her is my son, and he is 17. In fact, here in the United States, we have this concept where 16-year-olds, 17-year-olds, and 18-year-olds, while they're in what we call high school, they go to a celebration, a dance. It's very formal, it's called prom. And my son, Devron, his prom is today. So these are my 4 children. The next pictures I'll go through fairly quickly. The kids and I tend to travel quite often. On the left-hand side, we were in Las Vegas not too long ago in January. You see my son when he was younger, and then you see him now when he was, that was in January on the right-hand side. And then down below, we were celebrating Haley's birthday, which is in December. And so we stood by a Christmas tree. Just a couple of years ago, we were in New Orleans, Louisiana, which is a part of the southern part of the United States. And that's on the left-hand side. We also spent some time in Minnesota, which is in the northern part of the United States. That's the picture down below. And then we have a couple pictures from New York City. I think most of us are familiar with New York on the eastern part of the United States. And you can see, if you've been paying attention, my girls change their hair often, hair color, hair length, hairstyle. And you know, the reason I point that out is because it's an indicator of what is happening with the youth today. In my final pictures, you can see that we celebrate in many different ways. Celebrating Haley on the left-hand side, she was at a debutante. She was a debutante. We had a debutante ball. Haley up above also recently graduated, as I shared, her first 4 years of college. Tyler's there in the middle when she graduated some years earlier. And then Savannah and Devron at the bottom, and then some friends and family as well. So I hope that you were able to share some of the ways in which, as I was sharing about my family, ways that connected. There's one additional part that I'd like to share about my family before we go and I ask you this next question. My mother was the same age as my son now, so 17, when she was pregnant with me. And my father was really not there. He first went to the military and went to fight in a war. And then when he came back, he really was shaken up by that war and really was not a big part of my life. So my parents were my mother, my grandmother, and my aunt. You didn't see a picture of the aunt, but those were my parents growing up. My parents also did not get married because, from what I understand, during the time when my mother was pregnant with me, you saw the color of her skin, and my father is much lighter. And at that time, it was challenging for them. In fact, family members felt that, you know, my mother was too dark. These are all things that had an impact on my life. And I'll share more about that once we get into the concepts around diversity and equity and inclusion. But for now, I'd love to understand, Ela, were there any words that participants shared, you know, that connected with them as I was talking about my family?
Yes, we have Director Sandra Brown saying that family is so important, we often don't realize how important it is until sadness or loss shakes us. Mm-hmm. It's my mom and dad every day. And then we have a question from Teresa Harris, the membership chair. She was wondering why you were in so many locations at once.
I'll speak to that.
Okay. Someone from Lieutenant Governor from District 3, Dorothy, says that her mom's name is Mary as well.
Oh, wonderful, wonderful. And I'm yes, maybe one more.
Yes. Jamie Capehart says, my family is similar. I was raised by a stepmom and I'm raising my niece and nephew.
Wow, wow, thank you. Thanks for sharing that. So it's so interesting to me, this phenomena of the more that we're able to share of ourselves, the faster we're able to really build connections with each other in so many different ways. So next I ask, at your own level, comfort level of participating, what have you learned so far about what's important to me? And so, you know, the fast answer might be, oh, your kids or your family, and that is absolutely true. I shared some other details though. And so so maybe if you could share a few specifics, and then, you know, Eli, if you, as they're coming in, maybe if you could share maybe two or three of the responses with me, that would be great.
Pat Jarrett says, family, education, travel, connection.
Mm-hmm.
Alejandra, I'm going to mess up her last name, it's Kai Wicks, says that your father was not around, your father being out. I myself feel like you have the background where you have learned more from your mother about segregation and how people used to treat your background people differently. And so that may have affected the work you chose.
Mm-hmm. Wow. And I didn't even ask you to help me with that segue, but that is absolutely correct. I did not understand that there was this concept or these concepts called diversity, equity, inclusion, allyship, belonging. Had you asked me when I was making a decision about what college or university I would like to go to, or what career would I like to have, there was no way for me to be able to say, I want to be a diversity executive or practitioner, because at that time we weren't talking about these words in this way. But through life experience, it's really what then led me to beginning to study and practice and learn and grow around these concepts of diversity, equity, inclusion, allyship, and belonging. So today, just so that we have similar language to use, I'd like to spend just a little bit of time looking at the definitions of these words. Now, of course, these are working definitions, but these are definitions that actually came from the Cambridge Dictionary. I looked at Oxford Dictionary as well as Merriam and so many of the other popular dictionaries, but I landed with the Cambridge Dictionary. We'll spend a little bit more time on diversity, so I do not have that definition here yet. And also we'll spend a little bit more time on belonging, so I do not have that definition here yet. But let's go to equity. So there's an image here where you have three people standing, or three people actually watching a game. Who knows? Maybe it's a cricket game, maybe it's a baseball game, you know, but it's a game. And you can see that one person actually is standing, they're tall enough to look over the fence. The other person is using two crates or two boxes in order to help elevate the height to be able to see the game. And then the third person is using a ramp, because if you can see there, the third person is in a wheelchair. Equity really has to do with a situation when everyone is provided the same level of opportunity. I could go deeper into what's the difference between equity and equality. What I'll say here is there is a difference. And so equality basically focuses on, you know, trying to treat everyone the same. What equity is pointing out is sometimes if we treat everyone the same, not everyone will be able to view the game over the fence. Inclusion is really around the fact of including someone or something, especially in a group, amount, or event. There's a lot that could be said about inclusion. Again, this is the literal definition from the Cambridge Dictionary. There's a lot of work around inclusion and making sure you have an environment that's inclusive, but we will not go into that today. We just do not have the time. Allyship is the quality of practice of helping or supporting other people who are part of a group, even when you are not yourself a member of the group. I see allyship, especially since 2020, there's been lots of examples of allyship that have been shown around the world, but people standing up when there's a sense of injustice, or people standing up to really demonstrate how important it is that we're all treated with some of the words that are in your diversity statement, when we're all treated as if we're valued and also with respect as examples. Let's spend, however, a little bit more time on these two words or these two definitions, diversity and belonging. And the reason I'd like to stay here a little bit longer is because ultimately when I received the request to join you today, it was around how we can grow a diverse membership. And so these two words are very important for the answer to that question. So diversity, again, this is the definition from the Cambridge Dictionary, but diversity being the fact of many different types of things or people being included in something, a range of different things or people, or the fact that there are many different ideas or opinions or something. And I heard some of you talking about that earlier. Or even the fact of being people of different groups in society within an organization, or the fact that there being many different things existing together in a group. Here's how I talk about diversity, especially because most of the time I'm talking and working on diversity efforts within large organizations that the vast majority have been global. And then Eric shared with you all of the different industries and sectors that I've worked in. And so I think about diversity as the various ways we experience being human. And then when you think about the various ways we experience being human within the context of a culture, of an organization, of our families, of our countries, of our regions. That is really the work for us to, and the words and the area for us to pay attention to, especially if we're thinking about growing a diverse organization. Let me talk a little bit more about belonging. And then I also want to cover culture because I've used that word a couple of times now. Belonging is truly a feeling of being happy or comfortable as part of a particular group, or and having a good relationship with the other members in the group because they welcome you and they accept you. Now, Cambridge also included some additional definitions such as, you know, to be in the right place or to feel happy and comfortable in a place or with a group of people. So that also was a part of the definition from the Cambridge Dictionary. So let me just talk a little bit about culture. And there's so much that could be done with culture. In fact, my introduction to Zonta was actually working with the Zonta Club of Milwaukee. I know I saw at least one representative on this call today. And they were so gracious because we were able to take a deep dive into culture. And I'll share with you the reason why I made the request to do so. But we actually spent about a year together. Again, I had broken my leg during that time and my schedule was crazy, but we spent a lot of time going into culture. For today, just want to share a few key items regarding culture. A culture consists of unwritten and written principles and laws that guide how individuals interact with the outside world. You know, they are then taught, they're reinforced by other members in the group, which then becomes a shared system that is passed on from generation to generation. So let me give you a couple of practical examples. If I was to ask you, and you don't have to chat today for this one, but if I was to ask you, what is the Zonta culture? I suspect all of you could share some words that really represent and describe the Zonta culture. If I was to ask you, what is the culture of your country? I'm sure you could share many words. I also could probably ask you, what is the culture of your family? I think at the beginning of the call, someone shared that their family has a culture that surrounds US football. Now we could argue, what's the real football? Is it what the US calls soccer, or is it the National Football League? But when families come together around, you know, US football, or, you know, if we're or cricket or other sports, that's a part of the culture of the family. And so again, there's a lot more that we could go into in regards to culture, but that's just one example. So then when we come to the question around, you know, what or how do we value diversity or diversify the membership of the organization, understanding culture becomes very, very important. So what does belonging, now that we've gone through some definitions and we've talked a little bit about culture, valuing a culture of belonging is important, and I'll go more into that. But first, if you could, at your own comfort level, chat, what does belonging look like to you? And then, Ela, once we have some responses, maybe if you could share a few of those. What does belonging look like for you? Go ahead.
Someone wrote being able to share my voice. Liz Tessero wrote being able to share my voice. Jamie Capehart wrote being celebrated for being authentic. Donna Sroka said trusting. Rachel Lazarus says being seen, being heard. Luce Hodge Smith says acceptance. No, she said feeling appreciated. Janice Hermes, acceptance. Winnie Teo says being part of the same group.
That's helpful. Do you want to share a couple more, or are we good?
Marsha Restivo says spending time with people working toward a common goal. Okay. Being respected, being able to be myself.
Yeah. Thank you. Thank you, Ela, for sharing those. Sure. So I don't know about you, but as Ela was sharing the responses in the chat, I started to feel warm inside. Or in other words, it's very joyful. It's very comforting when there's this sense of belonging.
It's from America.
Now that
it's actually all over the world. There are people all
Okay, great. Thank you. So now that we've had a chance to go through some language, language that you can use as you continue to have this conversation at your particular Zonta club, now let's really answer this question. What does it take in order to grow a diverse Zonta club membership? And based upon my experiences thus far, these three areas or these three points are really what how I answer that question. First, it requires a club culture where each member and even potential members feel a sense of belonging. So I captured, you know, some of the words from the pillars, right? And so we've talked about, you know, the four pillars for diversity for Zonta clubs. And we talked about valuing and diversity and respect and a welcoming environment. And so all of those are absolutely very important. What I suggest is that you also explore and add a sense of belonging. I can show up to an organization, any organization, it doesn't have to be Zonta. I can show up to an activity and I can get many hellos and greetings and holas and, you know, benaka. And there's only two languages that I can sort of navigate, English, well, Spanish, a little bit. But, you know, but I can get a welcoming feeling. But I have been places where sometimes I felt welcome, but I didn't necessarily feel as if I belong. I don't know if some of you have felt that way before, but there is a difference. So growing a diverse membership requires a club culture where each member and potential members feel a sense of belonging. It also requires acknowledgement that we all have choices on how we would like to spend our time and make a difference in this world. I have been blown away by Zonta. Even as so many of you have joined today's call, you can feel the sisterhood. And what's so great is your mission, your purpose, your vision is focused on making a difference in the whole world, starting with where you are, but also contributing to the rest of the world. There are very few organizations that have that mission and purpose. And in addition to that, however, the world has absolutely changed. The world has changed where now I can also contribute to the world but not necessarily going in person to a club meeting, but perhaps engaging in a social media group that is also trying to make difference in the world. And so then if I have to make a decision between how I want to spend my time, I most likely will choose spending my time with a club or with an organization where I have a sense of belonging, because I have choices. The third point says it requires a willingness and a desire to really do a self-assessment, or in this case, a club assessment, for opportunities to truly strengthen diversity, equity, inclusion, allyship, and belonging within the culture of your club. So by really focusing on these three areas, what I've seen in working with other organizations is this is really foundational to the other organizations growing in regards to diversity. And this includes not just membership. For the work I do, it also includes growing in regards to employment, growing in regards to, you know, nonprofit organizations in a community. So this has been the way. So now let's move on. Here are some steps, and I'll just quickly go through these, but I know this recording will be available to you, so you might want to take them down, and you know, if there is a way to share the slide deck, that can be done as well. But basically, assess the current state of your club, and I'm talking about specifically when it comes to the culture or creating a sense of belonging. And one way to assess this, you can gather feedback from current members. have a discussion. Now I'm saying have a discussion because I'm in a culture that has direct communication. But depending upon where you are in the world, you know, there are many different ways to communicate and to gather this feedback from current members or even from past members, or even for those who you'd love to invite to really join Zonta. But you haven't yet. You can gather information and their thoughts from them as well. So whatever way, if it's an indirect way or direct way from a communication standpoint, but really try to assess the current state from a sense of belonging standpoint. Then once you have that information or that data or data, then you can develop an action plan by establishing goals and determining, you know, possible sources or places or other ways in which to have discussions for potential new members. And then also make sure that you're regularly asking and soliciting feedback as well as referrals as a part of, you know, this process. Once you have that action plan, then it's a matter of really just taking action and tracking your progress and then reassessing. Now, this 1, 2, 3, these three steps are applicable basically in anything that you do. If I was to take a look at my finances right now, I would want to know the current state. I would want to gather feedback from my banks, maybe from my family members, you know, or just, you know, my credit cards. I'd want to develop an action plan and set some goals. And then I'd want to track that action and reassess, right? So these three steps are not unique to the topic we're talking about today, but they are applicable. And that's the point here, that really these are things you're already doing probably for other areas when it comes to your Zonta Club. So please apply these same actions with the lens, with the thinking of creating a sense of belonging. So I know we are close at time. I just want to pause, and I actually will pull down my slides so that we can see each other. But I think this is a time for questions and answers. So let me just stop sharing.
I believe that Director Sandy has a question, and here we go. If belonging is so important to us as humans, how can we help our members to challenge this sense of belonging, to move out of their comfort zone, to accept people who are not like them or their friends in Zonta?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so Sandy, thank you so much for the question. The challenge becomes in really having the discussion. And so, you know, for some of us, especially for me, this is the work that I do. So I have made it my career to be the person to challenge and to be the person to, now I'm no longer uncomfortable having these discussions, but I know that when I have the discussions, that sometimes I'm having them with colleagues or club members from other organizations that maybe it makes them feel uncomfortable. In this day and age, we have social media that was developed specifically to create a sense of belonging. There are other organizations that are focusing on creating a sense of belonging. So the topic is a really important topic. And so I guess, Sandy, to your question, how it may be just maybe one or two of you right now in your club, that it may start with one or two of you, but hopefully the club gets to a place by continuing to have the dialogue about the sense of belonging, that then more will join in that conversation. So I hope I understood the question correctly. And if not, please maybe clarify it for me.
Heidi, Kim from USA, District 5. I'm in a club that's long established, but we don't mirror our community. We're in a large city. Mm-hmm. We have a diverse community. There's my dad doing his exercises. And yes, so down in Florida visiting my dad. But we, I've talked to members about that and we're trying, but I would love any advice on that. Again, I feel our clubs should mirror the communities we're serving and every community looks differently, but I can tell you, I don't think ours does. So any advice on that would be wonderful. Thank you.
Well, if I may ask you, so you've asked, right? You've asked and you've talked about the club. What are you hearing when you ask?
We don't know anybody from those areas. Mm. You know what I mean? They just don't know any people. It's Columbus, Ohio. It's a huge, diverse community, right? And people just are like, I don't know anybody who's Asian American. I don't know anybody who's Somali. I don't know anybody, you know? So unless we probably make a concerted effort to do it, go introduce Zonta to those areas, that's the only thing I can think of.
That is right? The answer. That is the answer. So I suspect that, as you mentioned, there are lots of organizations. There's probably, so Lunar New Year was earlier this year. Lots of celebration happening in the United States, more so than probably ever before. But of course, Lunar New Year is based upon, globally, there's celebrations. But for those of us, because, Kim, you're in the United States, for those of us here in the United States, let's go, come on, Zanchians, let's go to the Lunar New Year celebration. And we are going to, one, learn, because many of us probably have not been to a Lunar New Year celebration. In addition to that, we're going to introduce ourselves. So I have a business background, as you've heard. So I am going to use some business language. My feeling in being introduced to Zonta is that Zonta has a competitive advantage when you talk about your mission. And then when you talk about your mission globally. The fact that perhaps if I was to join Zonta and I was to contribute locally and I would have an opportunity to join President Uta, I'm making things up, President Uta, where she is right now in Frankfurt, or I would have had an opportunity to go to Milan because, right, there was an activity that took place in the Philippines recently. Or, Bombay is, we're trying to get something going in Bombay. If I had the opportunity to go to Bombay, right? That in itself and make a difference, not only locally, that's the competitive advantage that Zonta has. But if many of us do not know about it, and if you're not introducing yourselves in our communities, and by the way, if you're not introducing Zonta to folks that maybe are in a different generation, then you're absolutely right. It is a concerted effort that's required at this time. And while you're doing that of introducing yourself, let's also focus on our culture currently. Because once we introduce ourselves and we invite others to join Zonta, if our culture is not one where the new folks feel a sense of belonging, then they may not be there very long. So I'm sorry, I know I spent a lot of time, but that's the core of the response. So now I see lots of questions coming in. Thank you, Kim, for asking that question.
I don't see many questions, but I have a question.
Ela, okay. Oh, Ela, can I just, Heidi did ask me to elaborate on my original question, but it was really what Kim was saying. So I'd like to acknowledge Kim's question because I'm from Australia and my own club, everyone in our club looks like me. And I know, like Kim says, that's not reflective of my community. And it does take. So my question was really about how hard it is for us to break that comfort zone, to actually go out and embrace the community and get involved to invite those people. And I really applaud Kim's question, because it led to a great suggestion from you about the Lunar New Year. And I would say in Australia, coming up in July, we have NAIDOC Week, which is a celebration of our Indigenous communities. Mm-hmm. And Zonta, in my knowledge, has never got involved in that, and we should. Mm-hmm. So there's some great ideas, really, really terrific ideas that I hope a lot of people take on board.
And let me, so thank you so much, Sandy, for the clarification. Let me also share, I by no means want to make light of the fact of this might feel uncomfortable for by going to, you know, in spaces that maybe we've never been before. That might feel uncomfortable. The fact of the matter is that is the current state. When I started step one, what is the current state? Where we don't reflect the communities that we are serving. We haven't been to and made a concerted effort as much as we want to in order to go to where the folks that we, the people, right, that we want to invite, that we want to introduce to Zonta. So that's all a part of the current state. And part of the current state is I personally may feel uncomfortable making that concerted effort. But then when you take a look at the goals, but we want to increase diversity. Okay, so then what's the action? Okay, I'm going to have to be uncomfortable. I'm going to have to go where we've never gone before. So thank you so much for that clarification. Ela, I know we're close to time too.
Yeah. I mean, I have a quick question. So as an employer, when I hire a new employee, I call them into my office, and without creating a negativity, I'll say something like, how are you doing? Everybody teaching you new things? Are you uncomfortable about something? You're always welcome. How do you do that in Zonta without creating a negative environment?
So, but I think what you share, you know, the how are you doing, right? Depending upon where you are in the world, some of us are going to answer honestly. And we're going to tell you, I'm not doing too good today. And here's the reason why. You know, my colleague is not treating me nice or whatever. Others of us maybe will not answer honestly, right? We'll answer as honest as we choose to. And our comfort level might be, I'll say I'm doing well, right? So at the beginning, I opened up to share various ways around when you understand what's important to me, then you're going to try to connect with me at that place, right? Mm-hmm. And so that's the challenge. That's another part of the challenge of trying to learn what's important to someone so that you can connect with them.
Yes, great point. Well, I think at this time, if
I think Teresa also has put in a question, Ela.
Yes. Teresa, when different people with different perspectives come into a club, they soon leave when the unwelcome mat comes out. Their perspective isn't welcome. What do people think about challenging club members to get points for saying this phrase? Thank you. I never thought of it like that.
So is that sounds like a question maybe for those of you who have experience with the club members.
Yeah, so basically I think what, in a way, her question is something like a suggestion that, you know, instead of saying we've never heard about it, or we don't do it that way, instead of that, if we start giving rewards or plus points to people who use the phrase, I never thought about it that way, please share more about it, kind of thing. That's one way of making people feel welcome.
Especially with the thank you. show mm-hmm. some appreciation.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, my Zonta Club of Porterville has been wonderful for me. Like, we had a scholarship night. It was a busy evening. And I had a guest from Mumbai who we support because he runs a school in the slums. Mm. And I called them up and I said, hey, this is a great opportunity. We should have him talk. We didn't have time, but they said, hey, yeah, if you say it is important for us to hear him, we'll make time, bring him along. And we had a great evening with him talking about his program in the slums. Mm. So I think Zonta Club of Porterville is wonderful. That brings me to our final section of the hour. Madalena, I want to thank Heidi. It's been a great experience knowing you and meeting you. I think we became friends. Mm-hmm. And now I will turn it over to Madalena.
Thank you very much. It's my honor to say the vote of thanks. So I would like to thank you, Heidi, for bringing your expertise to Zonta, as well as for the insights into this subject. And I think this is an important subject to us as individuals, but also for developing Zonta further. And many thanks, Alison and Megan, the Zonta International team at the headquarters, for making this possible for everybody to have this platform to converse. Thank you, Sandy, for supporting us, the working group, and of course, to President Ute for being with us today from the conference. But also a big thank you to the governors promoting and talking about the Greater Diversity webinar. But lastly, and most importantly today, it's you, the participants, the Zontians, and also the guests for joining us. And we wish you all the best from Sweden, from USA, from India, and Australia on behalf of the committee. So take care and see you soon.
Madeline, if they have any questions, further questions, we can give them an email link so they could definitely ask more questions. We'll be happy to discuss and answer them at the earliest.
Okay, so we are done with the formal program so that whoever has time commitments, they can leave. Those who want to hang out a little longer and chat about this, they are welcome to do so. And I'm putting my email in the chat box. So if you have more questions that we can get answers for you, please email me your questions. And thank you for joining today.
Thank you. And to everybody, we will package this session. It will get posted next week. And there will be a follow-up email that will be sent to the individuals who attended and registered. But we're happy, as Ela said, to keep the line open for a few more minutes. Heidi, again, thank you so much. Otherwise, to everybody else, have a great rest of your day or your evening. And we appreciate you.
Good to see you too, Cheryl. I'm going now. It's very, very, very
okay,
late.
Sandy.
So
good night, Sandy.
Thank you, Sandy.
We'll
good
see
night.
You when you
good
wake night. Up, Sandy.
I'm gonna go up. Yeah. I'm gonna go to bed.
Okay.
Bye. Regards to all.
Okay.
Very interesting.
Bye. Bye. Nice seeing you.
Thank you.
Bye.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Hi,
sign off now.
Nice seeing you after a long time. Bye, Adriana.
Bye-bye. Nice to see you all.
Bye-bye. Bye-bye. Thank you. Thank you for joining in.
Okay. Well, if there's no further conversation or questions, yes. I'm going to go ahead and close this session, and we yes. will see everybody at the next session. Bye.
Yes.